Hello and welcome to the Chirping Pigeons YouTube channel. Welcome back if you've already checked out some of our content. We really appreciate you guys helping us out. In today's video, we're going to be breaking down all four divisions in the NHL headed into the 2023-2024 season. We're going to begin with the Atlantic Division, talking about the Boston Bruins. Obviously, they had a career year last year with 65 wins, 135 points. I think there's definitely some regression coming from this team, though. They did lose a couple key guys in Dmitry Orlov, Tyler Bertuzzi, Taylor Hall, Patrice Bergeron obviously retired, and David Krejci's at least taken a step back from playing in the NHL. It's going to be hard to replace Patrice Bergeron. Boston now doesn't really have a solidified, I would even say top six center, besides even like a 1C where Pavel Zacha or Charlie Coyle is going to end up playing this year. Like I said, it's going to be really hard to replace Patrice Bergeron and play that solid two-way hockey. Zacha could probably put up some pretty solid numbers playing with David Pastrnak like he did last year. The thing with this Bruins team, though, is they still have a really solid decor and really good goaltending tandem, which might be the best in the NHL, to be quite honest with you. They didn't really change much of their D. All that really happened was Connor Clifton was out. Kevin Shattenkirk came in. I could see this team relying on their defensive play a lot to ride them into the playoffs, along with super solid goaltending. Jeremy Swayman was awesome last year, and Linus Allmark was obviously a Vezina-caliber goaltender. They just honestly need both these guys to play really well. If not, one of them to play really well and kind of carry the load. I think the Boston Bruins are still going to end up making the playoffs, but I don't think it's going to end up being in first place in this division. As I said, they've lost some key guys, and I think that's going to make them drop from first in this division. On now to the Toronto Maple Leafs. They definitely have an interesting team now without Kyle Dubas this year. Brad Treliving has came in and made some solid moves up front, bringing in Tyler Bertuzzi from the Boston Bruins. He brought in Max Domi, Ryan Reeves, and on the back end, he brought in John Klingberg, Simone Benoit, and he brought in Martin Jones as goaltender insurance. I think the Leafs are looking pretty solid heading into this season, at least for the regular season. I like the grit they brought in Tyler Bertuzzi, Max Domi. These guys can also produce offensively. The back end's a little bit of a question mark for me, though. They lost a guy in Luke Shen who was solid, a guy they really need with that grit, and he hits a lot on the back end. And they brought in a puck-moving defenseman in John Klingberg. I do think they did lack a little bit of puck-moving in the playoffs last year. I think Klingberg is going to help in that aspect, but I'm still a little bit worried for them considering they didn't replace a guy in Luke Shen. I think it's probably something they are going to address during the season, as Brad Treliving in the past with Calgary likes his kind of big, gritty defensemen. I think their goaltending tandem too is looking pretty solid. Samsonov had a really good season last year, and Joseph Woll was pretty good last year in the AHL and the games that he played in the NHL. I think the Leafs are going to definitely make the playoffs this year, and they have a chance of fighting for first place in the Atlantic Division. On now to the Tampa Bay Lightning. I think this team has definitely regressed a little bit. I don't think they're nearly as deep as they were when they won the two Stanley Cups and even made it to the Stanley Cup Finals. This year, they lost their entire fourth line in Bellemare, Perry, and Maroon. They also traded away Ross Colton. They brought in some guys in Luke Glendening, Tyler Mott. I don't know if this team is really even good enough to end up making the playoffs, to be honest, in this Atlantic Division, especially without Andrei Vasilevsky for the first 2 months. Their decor is definitely looking thinner as well. They got Hedman, Cernak, Sergachev are kind of their anchors up there. Darren Radish proved to play really well with Mikhail Sergachev last year. But they got Calvin DeHaan coming in to potentially even play in the top four. He was a seventh defenseman with the Hurricanes last year. I still think these guys are a solid team, but I think of how hard this division is and how hard the Metro is as well, just because with the last wild card spot getting in. I think Tampa does definitely have the possibility of making the playoffs, but I would not be surprised at all if they miss this season. Talking now about the Florida Panthers, obviously, they went on this magical run to the Stanley Cup Finals last year. We kind of have to see whether they end up responding well from that or not. They didn't really make too many changes to their roster. They're coming in with the same goaltending tandem. They did bring in Anthony Stolarz as insurance as well. On defense, Montour and Ekblad are out for a little bit after going through surgery after that Stanley Cup Final run. They did bring in Oliver Ekman-Larsson, Nico Mikkola, Mike Riley. They are looking a little bit different last year, but they did lose a guy in Radko Gudas who was also really solid for them. And up front, they didn't really make too many changes. They did trade Anthony Duclair to the Florida Panthers, got Steven Lorenz back, then also brought in Evan Rodriguez, who I thought was a really solid signing, a guy who can play the right wing and center. I think Florida's still looking in pretty good shape as long as they can hold down the fort without Montour and Ekblad. OEL is going to have to step up and potentially play like a top pairing defenseman at least for the time that Montour and Ekblad are out. Talking about the Buffalo Sabres, I think this is a really exciting season for Buffalo. They obviously did not make the playoffs by a single point last year. They're a really young team. They have potential at every single position. The one question mark for them is definitely their goaltending. Devon Levi looked really solid when he came into the NHL last year. But can he perform like this in a starter's role for the whole year? We're not really too sure yet. Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen kind of had that job last year over Erik Komrie and Craig Anderson. He didn't perform too well, though, but he did have a decent record. So their goaltending is going to be a huge dependency on their success. Their defense is looking a little bit different, moving out Ilya Lyubushkin, bringing in Connor Clifton and Eric Johnson. I think this is a pretty solid move, considering you got guys in Rasmus Dahlin, Owen Power, and Henry Jokiharju, who are more offensive-minded. It's good to bring in a guy like Connor Clifton, who's really defensive-minded. And onto their forwards now, they didn't really make many changes whatsoever. Vinny Hinostroza is on his way out. Zach Benson, who was drafted 13th overall this year, has a really good shot of making the team. I believe he's got 7 points in 7 preseason games up to this point. He could potentially make the team. Give him a 9-game trial, see what he can do. He's looking really solid. This is a really exciting season to be a Buffalo Sabres fan, in my opinion. I'd be optimistic about them making the playoffs. I think goaltending is going to be a huge dependency on that. This is a really tough decision, and you got to get good goaltending if you want to make it into the playoffs. On now to the Ottawa Senators. This is a huge make-or-break year for the Ottawa Senators, I think, especially for the jobs of DJ Smith and Pierre Dorion. They did not make too many changes, and they're kind of in a little bit of a cap situation right now, not being able to sign Shane Pinto. He was a 20-goal scorer for them last season. Looked really good as a third-line center. They didn't make any changes to their decor whatsoever. They did bring back Travis Hamonic, which kind of forced them to put Jacob Bernard Docker and Lassie Thompson on waivers. Lassie Thompson obviously claimed by the Anaheim Ducks. I don't think their decor is looking too solid. I'm curious to see what a full season of Jacob Chychrun looks like. I'm assuming he is going to be playing the right side, probably along with Shabbat. And Sanderson's going to be in that top four with Artem Zub. Their goaltending's obviously looking a little bit different. Cam Talbot is out. Jonas Korpisalo is in. Korpisalo had a really solid season last year. Before that, though, he was kind of iffy with the Blue Jackets. Looking to see how he ends up performing this year. Can he take over that number one job over Anton Forsberg? It is a pretty solid goalie tandem they have. They need one of those guys to be really good, though, to guide them into the playoffs. I'm not too sure if they're good enough in this division to make the playoffs. They definitely have an incredible top six, but there's still some question marks about their team. Taking a look now at the Detroit Red Wings. Detroit, in my opinion, is not really good enough to make the playoffs. I know that they're wanting to push to make it this year, though. They brought in some guys in JT Compher, Justin Hall, Jeff Petrie, Shane Gostisbehere, James Reimer. They're looking to make the playoffs this year. I don't know if this roster is necessarily good enough. Besides Moritz Seider on defense, I think there's a pretty huge drop-off, especially after trading Filip Hronek at last year's deadline. Their forward prospects have not really turned out as planned, I think, so far. Lucas Raymond, I think they're expecting a little bit more from to become more of a solidified top six player. Jonathan Bregerin was pretty solid for them last year, too. I think they're hoping that he could maybe jump into a top six role, but at least play in the top nine. I think Detroit's probably looking to finish in like bottom three on this division, to be quite honest. I know Stevie Y is getting a little bit impatient, and that's why he went out this offseason and made moves for these guys to bring them in and make them better, because their prospects have not really been developing as planned. Finally, looking at the Montreal Canadiens, they really didn't do much this offseason. They're pretty tight to the cap as Marc Bergeron left Ken Hughes with some pretty bad contracts. All they really did was move out Mike Hoffman, Rem Pitlick, Joel Edmondson. They did bring in Tanner Pearson and Alex Newhook. Curious to see how Alex Newhook's going to look in a new environment, as he didn't really get a top six opportunity with the Colorado Avalanche. This team, I think it's more they need their youth to grow in Cole Caulfield, Nick Suzuki, Kirby Dach, Newhook, Raphael Harvey-Pinard, and some of their defense in Caden Gooley, Arbor Jacki, Jordan Harris. And their goaltending might be a little bit of a question mark this year. Both of the goalies in Sam Montembeau and Jake Allen have never both really looked good at the same time. I'm curious to see if their goaltending is going to be solid this year or potentially let them down. But I don't really see a situation where Montreal is not finishing last in this division. So my final prediction for the Atlantic Division, I have the Toronto Maple Leafs winning the division, the Florida Panthers coming in second, the Buffalo Sabres finishing in third, and the Boston Bruins finishing in that fourth place in the Atlantic Division and getting the only wildcard spot in this Atlantic Division. Moving on now to the Metro Division, we're going to talk about the Carolina Hurricanes first. Carolina's still got a really solid team. They definitely added to their decor this offseason, bringing back Tony D'Angelo, bringing in Dmitry Orlov. They definitely have the deepest decor in the NHL, which is no surprising. They're running with the same three goaltenders as last year as well, in Frederik Andersen, Antti Raanta, and Pyotr Kochetkov. Andersen and Raanta have known to have injury troubles. Kochetkov may get his chance to be their starting goalie for at least a little bit of this season. And taking a look at their forwards now, they didn't really make too many moves. Max Pacioretty's obviously out. Andrei Svechnikov's coming back after tearing his ACL last season. I think Carolina's in a really good position this year. They definitely have a chance of fighting for first place in this Metro Division. New Jersey's looking really good, though, too, so I think it's going to be a dogfight for who comes out first in this division. Looking now at the New Jersey Devils roster heading into this season, one trade they made was bringing in Tyler Toffoli for the Calgary Flames in exchange for Yegor Sharangovich. New Jersey definitely let a couple guys go this year in Miles Wood, Ryan Graves, Damon Severson. I think it was definitely necessary, though. They have a guy in Alexander Holtz who deserves a shot in the top nine, I think. And on defense, they got Luke Hughes, Kevin Ball, and potentially Simone Nemec coming up. So I think it was worth definitely letting Ryan Graves and Damon Severson go. Their goaltending might be a little bit of a question mark in Vitek Vanacek and Akira Schmid. Schmid was great last year, but he's also really young and could go through some growing pains. Vitek Vanacek was solid during the regular season last year, but kind of fumbled when playoffs came. I think their team is at least good enough to carry these goalies if they don't play good, but I think New Jersey has a really solid team, and like I said before, I think it's going to be a dogfight between them and the Carolina Hurricanes for winning this Metropolitan Division. Taking a look now at the New York Rangers, Rangers didn't really have too much turnover this year, besides losing Vladimir Tarasenko and Patrick Kane. Patrick Kane, obviously, there's still a possibility he could return to New York if he does take more of like a league minimum type deal. They did bring in Blake Wheeler at $800,000 cap hit, which is really great to see. Added some depth guys in Nick Bonino, Alex Balzil, and Riley Nash. And on defense, not too much of a change. Nico Mikkola's out. Eric Gustafson is in. The Rangers didn't really have too much cap to work with. They also replaced their backup goaltender with Jonathan Quick, who's looking to still play after having a really rough season last year. I think he could probably be solid backup for Igor Shesterkin. I don't really see the Rangers kind of moving in the regular season. They did finish with 107 points last year, which is really good, but I see them this year still finishing in third place in this Metropolitan Division and having a tough matchup in the first round in New Jersey or Carolina. Talking now about the New York Islanders, obviously Lou does not like to make too many moves. They're looking really similar. The only real change is traded Justin Bailey to the Chicago Blackhawks, and he ended up being bought out. Zach Parise is still questionable whether he's going to end up playing this season or not. Besides that, they just re-signed guys in Varlamov, Sorokin, Mayfield, Pierre Engvall. I don't really think this team is good enough to make the playoffs, to be quite honest with you. I could see them taking a step back. They're relying on Ilya Sorokin way too much, to be quite honest, and I don't think they have the scoring it takes to make the playoffs. I think they're going to be caught in too many 1-0, 2-1, 3-2 games where they're just not able to get that goal to give them that extra point, and I think they're going to end up missing the playoffs by a couple points. Taking a look now at the Pittsburgh Penguins, they obviously made some major changes this offseason. After not making the playoffs for the first time in Sidney Crosby's career, their biggest move was definitely bringing in Erik Karlsson from the San Jose Sharks. I think he's going to be looking really good with this team. He was an over an 100-point defenseman last year, and he wasn't really playing with many great forwards whatsoever. Now he's playing with Crosby, Malkin, Gensel. I think their power play is going to be great this year. On forward, they obviously made some changes, especially to their depth. They just claimed Jansen Harkins off waivers, brought in Lars Eller. I thought that was really solid as like a third-line center. They lost Jason Zucker, but were able to replace him in Riley Smith in a solid trade with the Vegas Golden Knights. But I think the real question mark for Pittsburgh on them making the playoffs is going to be their goaltending. Jari was injured a lot last year. Casey DeSmith was good when he played, but he's not a starting caliber goalie. Tristan Jarry and Alex Nedeljkovic are going to have to play really well this year, and I think it's going to be a huge dependency on the Pittsburgh Penguins making the playoffs. On now to the Washington Capitals. Washington did not really make many changes whatsoever. Their biggest move was probably bringing in Max Pacioretty. Hopefully he can stay healthy this year and play in their top six. I think he can be a really solid addition to their team. Another young guy they brought in who hasn't really gotten an NHL chance is Matthew Phillips. backups, but he's teared up the AHL when he's played. Really small player. Hoping he can contribute to Washington and give them success. On defense, the only real move they made was bringing in Joel Edmondson from the Montreal Canadiens. He's going to be more of like a third-pairing type guy, though. He's gone through some injury troubles and has missed most of training camp right now, so I'm assuming Alexander Alexiev is going to step into that role. Washington, I don't really see much improvement from last year, to be honest. Maybe by a couple points, but I don't see them making the playoffs. On out of the Philadelphia Flyers. The Flyers made some moves this offseason, sending out Ivan Provorov and Kevin Hayes, bringing back some like bad contracts and Sean Walker, Cal Peterson, who was just sent down to the AHL. I think the Flyers are probably looking to be one of the worst teams in the Metro Division. They are getting Sean Couturier and Cam Atkinson back, who missed all of last season due to injury. I don't really have high expectations for this team whatsoever. I think they've accepted to go through some growing pains, get some good picks before they can get better. Taking a look now at the Columbus Blue Jackets, I think Columbus has a pretty interesting team this year. Jarmo Kekalainen made some moves to bring in some defensemen in Damon Severson and Ivan Provorov. Zach Werenski's going to be playing this year. He barely played last year after a season-ending injury. And up front, probably their biggest acquisition is Adam Fantilli, who was drafted third overall. Curious to see what this kid can do. I think Columbus is going to be an exciting team to watch. They could potentially finish last in this division, but they could also make a push and potentially be a couple points outside of the playoffs. But at the end of the day, I do not see them qualifying for the playoffs this year. So taking a look at my final rankings for the Metro Division, I have Carolina finishing first, New Jersey finishing second, the New York Rangers finishing third, and the Pittsburgh Penguins getting that last wild card spot in fourth place in the Metro Division. Moving on now to the Central Division and the Colorado Avalanche. Colorado cannot be too happy after being bounced in the first round by the Seattle Kraken last year. Definitely made a couple changes to their forward core, bringing in Ross Colton, Ryan Johansson, Thomas Tatar, Jonathan Drouin. I like the bets that this team has made to fill in some holes. Obviously, Gabriel Landeskog is not playing at least the regular season this year. I think a guy like Jonathan Drouin, if he gets the chance to play with McKinnon and Rantanen, can look really solid, especially as a pass-first type player. Ryan Johansson's an interesting case coming off a down year. Wondering if he can produce like a 2C in Colorado. And I really like the Ross Colton pickup for him to play third line center. He's obviously a Stanley Cup champion with the Tampa Bay Lightning and plays that gritty style. I think Georgiev's going to be really solid again for them. They have a really awesome D-core. Devontae, Kale McCarr, Sam Girard, Josh Manson, Bowen Byram. I think Colorado's going to be fighting for first place in this division. I think they might end up getting it. I think it's going to depend on how healthy they are and if these new guys are able to produce coming in. Moving on now to the Dallas Stars. I think Dallas has got a great team this year. Their biggest pickup was bringing in Matt Duchene after he was bought out from the Nashville Predators. The good thing about Matt Duchene, I think this guy can play on your first line. I think he can play on your third line. The year before last, he's set 43 goals, which is really good. He can also play right wing along with center, even as a left-handed shooting player. They have a lot of options here to move guys to the wing, move them to center. Joe Pavelski, obviously playing right wing on that first line with Roope Hintz. He could also be playing center. I'm assuming their centers are going to be Tyler Seguin, Roope Hintz, and maybe Matt Duchene, to be quite honest with you. Wyatt Johnson's another guy that comes to mind that could play that position. He was a 19-year-old last year with 24 goals. Their defense is looking really good with Miro Heiskanen, Esa Lindell. I do think that Dallas could potentially make a move throughout the season to bring in another top four defenseman if they can make the cap work. One guy who I think is going to be solid for them back there this year is Thomas Harley. He played a little bit in the playoffs last year. Hopefully he can take a step and maybe take that top four position, move Ryan Suter down. I think Suter's definitely more suited to be in that bottom pairing at this point. I think Jake Ottinger's going to have another great season. I think Dallas is looking pretty good, and I think they're going to be fighting with Colorado for first place in this division. Taking a look now at the Minnesota Wild. Minnesota didn't really make too many moves this offseason. They're obviously tight to the cap, considering this Parise and Suter buyout, which is taking up $14 million in cap space. They pretty much just re-signed some guys, and their biggest re-signing was probably goaltender Philip Gustafson, who was awesome last year. I think you're going to see him take a bigger role and play more games this year. Marc-Andre Fleury probably going to be sitting there more as a backup, but a really good backup in that case. He can step in and play well. We've all seen. One guy I'm interested to see on this team this year is Brock Faber. They kind of let Matt Dumba go because Brock Faber is ready to step into that role. He could be playing with Jonas Brodin this year. He's really defensive-minded as well. They could be a really solid shutdown pair. A guy up front who I think Minnesota fans are looking to break out this year is Marco Rossi. He was a top 10 pick a couple years ago. Has been really solid in the AHL with Iowa, but hasn't broken out in the NHL whatsoever. I think Minnesota's looking pretty good heading into this season. They could be finishing in a top three spot, but we'll see. They're going to have good goaltending again. They've always had good defense, so as long as those things go right, I can see them making the playoffs again. Taking a look now at the Winnipeg Jets. Obviously, Winnipeg has an interesting case. They bought out Blake Wheeler this summer. Pierre-Luc Dubois pretty much refused to sign with them. They got a pretty good return, though, in Gabe Vilardi, Rasmus Kupari, Alex Iafallo. They got a pick in as well. I think Winnipeg's probably looking around that mid-pack range. Connor Hellebuck and Mark Scheifele are obviously question marks of whether or not they are going to re-sign. I think the right decision for this team would be able to trade these guys, get some picks back. Winnipeg has struggled to bring in guys via unrestricted free agency, so they're having to build through the draft and developing and trades. I think that the best decision for them, trade these guys, get some picks, prospects back, see how the season goes as well. Connor Hellebuck hasn't really ruled out the fact that he would re-sign with this team, but it's all going to depend on their success, and I don't really see this team taking a step forward from last year whatsoever. Taking a look now at the Nashville Predators. Nashville's got a pretty interesting team. They obviously moved out a bunch of guys at the deadline last year. Tanner Jeannot, Nino Niederreiter, Matthias Ekholm. They're going pretty young here. They had some guys who were solid last year in Tommy Novak and Juuso Parsonen. I think Luke Evangelista, Philip Tomasino are going to take a really big step this year, potentially play on the top six, top two power plays as well. And another guy who had a great season last year, I thought, was Cody Glass, who never really found his place in Vegas's lineup whatsoever. Got traded to Nashville and looked really solid. They brought in a couple guys this offseason in Ryan O'Reilly, Luke Shen, some really good vets, some Stanley Cup champions who I think is going to help their young core. I think Nashville's probably going to be around the same position as they were last year, kind of fighting for that playoff spot. I'm not too sure if they're good enough, but I think their season really depends obviously on UC Saros, who's been an elite starting goalie for years. But if he somehow does have an off year, I think this team is not looking too good to make the playoffs in the Central Division. But I would bet on UC Saros having a really great season this year and them fighting for that last wildcard spot. Taking a look now at the St. Louis Blues. St. Louis really hasn't made any changes from last year after shipping out O'Reilly, Tarasenko at the deadline last year. Their only real big move is bringing in Kevin Hayes at center. He's probably going to be playing in their top six, I'd assume. And for goaltending, they don't have Thomas Greiss anymore, but young goaltender Joel Hofer is going to be taking the step to the NHL. He was really good in the AHL last year. I think that he could potentially even push Binnington for his starting goalie job. I don't really like the makeup of their defense, to be quite honest with you. I don't think Colton Parayko is a number one D whatsoever. He's more of like a number two, number three guy, and he's probably sitting there as their best defenseman. I don't really think St. Louis is going to be any different from last year, to be quite honest with you. I think they're going to be sitting around with that 500 record, 5th to 6th in this division, and they're going to be missing the playoffs for the second straight season. Taking a look now at the Arizona Coyotes, I think the Coyotes actually have a really interesting team this year. Their biggest acquisition is probably bringing in Logan Cooley, who they drafted 3rd overall in 2022. He's probably going to be plugged right into the top 6 and play center. He's looking really good. They also brought in Jason Zucker, Matt Dumba. They brought back Nick Bjugstad. I think Arizona has a really interesting team. I don't think that they're going to end up making the playoffs, but I think they're going to be one of these teams that are there near the end. They could be out by 5 points or so. They could be very similar to the way Buffalo was last year, really exciting to watch. They do have a bright future with all the top picks they've had. Arizona's definitely a team that I'm going to be tuning into this season because I'm interested to see how Logan Cooley does and some of their new guys. The final team in the Central Division is the Chicago Blackhawks. Obviously, the most interesting guy on this team is Connor Bedard. Curious to see what he can do. I kind of think he's going to be putting up somewhere between 70 to 80 points. I think he could be looking somewhere near 40 goals as well. This guy's got an elite level shot already. Curious to see how Taylor Hall ends up performing beside him as well. Besides that, Chicago did not really make too many moves this year. Their other notable guys were bringing in Ryan Donato, Corey Perry, and Nick Foligno. I don't see this team making the playoffs. I wonder if Connor Bedard is going to be good enough to kind of carry them out of last place in this division, though. I think they're going to end up finishing around 6th place. I think it's going to be really interesting to tune into their games this year to see Connor Bedard, who looks like he's going to be a generational type player. So taking a look at my final predictions for this Central Division, I only have 3 teams making the playoffs, and I have Colorado finishing in 1st, Dallas finishing in 2nd, and the Minnesota Wild finishing in 3rd, while Winnipeg will not make the playoffs this year, meanwhile they did last year. Moving on to the final division in this video, the Pacific Division, starting off with the Vegas Golden Knights. Vegas is obviously coming off their first Stanley Cup this year. Did not have too much change to their roster. They didn't bring anyone in. They did lose a couple guys, though, in Riley Smith, Phil Kessel, Jonathan Quick. They're still sitting there with the same decor, which is definitely one of the best in the NHL. I don't really see much regression coming from this Vegas Golden Knights team, to be quite honest. I think maybe at worst they're dropping to like second place in the division, but they're definitely going to be making the playoffs and definitely going to be a huge threat to win the Stanley Cup once again. They could definitely pick up someone at the deadline. They're really tight to the cap, though. They've shown that they're not afraid to trade guys away, especially in an original misfit in Riley Smith, just to bring back Ivan Barbashev this year, who was a huge part of their Stanley Cup run. But I think Vegas is finishing either first or second in this division. Moving on now to the Edmonton Oilers. The Oilers, like the Golden Knights, did not make too many moves this year. Their biggest move was bringing in Connor Brown from the Washington Capitals, who didn't play much last year at all. They're getting him on a solid cap hit at $775,000. The other forward who they brought in was Lane Pettersson, who was playing with the Columbus Blue Jackets last season. I think he's probably going to be playing on the third or fourth line. Curious to see how he ends up doing and how he ends up producing. He's a pretty solid player. Their defense and goaltending are looking the exact same. I still think they kind of have a hole in their top four. I don't like Cody Ceci playing in that second pair right-handed shooting defenseman role. I think Edmonton's probably going to look to do something at the deadline. Like Vegas, they don't really have any cap room whatsoever. But if they can somehow make a move work to send money out, bring money back in, I think it'd be beneficial for their team. They're definitely going to be making the playoffs as well. Curious to see if Jack Campbell can respond, and they'll have a really solid tandem if Stuart Skinner is able to play like he did last season. Moving on now to the Los Angeles Kings, LA's biggest move this offseason was bringing in Pierre-Luc Dubois from the Winnipeg Jets. They probably have one of the deepest center cores in the NHL with Anze Kopitar, Pierre-Luc Dubois, Philippe Deneau, and Blake Lizotte. I really like the way that's looking head into this season. I think this team is made up really well, especially in the top nine. On defense, they moved out Sean Durzi this year, but they got a young guy in Brant Clark coming in who tore up the OHL last season. But one question mark for this team is probably their goaltending. They lost Jonas Korpisalo to free agency last year. They brought in Cam Talbot and David Riddick. I don't know if either of these guys are going to be able to be good enough to carry them to a Stanley Cup. I think they have a solid enough team that these guys can hold down the fort to get them to the playoffs. But I think LA might be looking for a goalie replacement come trade deadline like they did this past season. Taking a look now at the Seattle Kraken. Seattle's looking pretty similar to what they did last season. Most notable move was probably bringing in Brian Dumoulin from the Pittsburgh Penguins, but losing Carson Soucy, who ended up going to the Vancouver Canucks. I think Seattle's a real gritty team. They don't really have many or if any superstars. I think Matty Beniers is definitely on his way there. Curious to see if Jared McCann can put up 40 goals once again. He's been really solid and a really underrated player for this team. And another question mark for them is whether Philip Grubauer can play really well during the regular season. I thought he was great in the playoffs last year, but he has not played too well in the both regular seasons since coming over from the Colorado Avalanche. They have a new backup goaltender in Joey Decord, who led Coachella to the Calder Cup Finals last year. They lost Martin Jones to the Toronto Maple Leafs. So I'm curious to see if this goalie tandem is good enough to get them into the playoffs this year. Taking a look now at the Calgary Flames. Calgary is a team that I'm looking to see how they respond this year. They didn't really make too many changes. Tyler Toffoli is the one guy who went out, and Sharon Govich is coming in. Oliver Shillington is not returning this season. They brought in Jordan Esterle from the Detroit Red Wings. Their goaltending tandem is looking the same right now in Jacob Markstrom and Dan Vladar. But they also have Dustin Wolf, who is back-to-back AHL Goalie of the Year. It looks like he's being sent down and starting the season in the AHL. I really wonder if Dan Vladar could be on the move and Dustin Wolf could be brought up at some point to play with Jacob Markstrom. I would expect a bounce-back season from Jacob Markstrom, to be quite honest with you. I would expect a bounce-back season from this team in general. I think Calgary is going to respond really well. They have a great decor, and I think you're looking at them making the playoffs this year. Taking a look now at the Vancouver Canucks. The Canucks did not make too many moves this offseason. It was mostly to address their depth, bringing in Pia Suter, Teddy Bluger, and on defense they brought in Ian Cole and Carson Soucy. They did make a trade with the Canadiens recently that brought in a new backup goaltender in Casey DeSmith, and sending out Tanner Pearson was mostly a cap move to get them cap compliant. I don't really see much movement coming from this Vancouver Canucks team. I think they're kind of like a mid-pack team, to be quite honest with you. They have a really great goaltender in Demko. They got Quinn Hughes, who's an anchor back there. And then Elias Pettersson is easily probably around a top seven center in the entire league. I'm curious to see how these guys end up playing this year. I think this is a really tough Pacific division, though, and I don't think that Vancouver's going to end up getting into the playoffs. Taking a look now at the San Jose Sharks. San Jose obviously moved out Timo Meier at the trade deadline last year, and they moved out Erik Karlsson in the offseason this year. So, I mean, they only had 22 wins and 60 points last year with an 100-point score in Erik Karlsson. San Jose, I think their plan is to not be great this year. They're probably going to get some young guys in the lineup in William Eklund, Thomas Bortolo, probably Henry Thrun on defense as well. Their goaltending tandem this year is Kaapo Kähkönen and Mackenzie Blackwood. I think San Jose is honestly going to be competing for that first overall pick this year. But I think for San Jose Sharks fans, this is what you want. They don't really have a great team. They weren't good with Timo Meier and Erik Karlsson for most of the season last year. So I think this is a case of you got to be bad before you can be good. I'd be happy as a Sharks fan if they end up getting the first overall pick. On out of the final team in the NHL is the Anaheim Ducks. They obviously went through some hard contract negotiations recently with Jamie Drysdale and Trevor Zegras. They ended up bringing them back, though, which is good to see. They'll be starting the season with them. Their most notable moves this offseason, bringing in Alex Killorn from the Tampa Bay Lightning. They also brought in Radko Gudas from the Florida Panthers, Ilya Lyubushkin from the Buffalo Sabres. They're going to be a little bit of a harder team to play against this year. I don't really see much improvement coming, though. They're probably still a bottom 5-7-ish team in the league. They're going to be harder to play against, definitely, with Lyubushkin and Radko Gudas back there. They definitely got pushed around a little bit too much. Those guys are brought in, I think, to protect some of their future stars in Trevor Zegras, Mason McTavish, Troy Terry. I think Anaheim, you just want your young guys to develop well, especially a guy like Jamie Drysdale who didn't play much last season. He's got a lot to prove. I think he has the potential to be a top pairing defenseman eventually, but these next two seasons are going to be a real make or break season for Jamie Drysdale. And in that, you got John Gibson with Lucas Dostal. I think Alex Stalock might play some games as well. John Gibson might be on his way out. It seems like he's not really too interested in staying there anymore. We'll see if Anaheim ends up getting a solid return for him, and he could be on his way out the door. And I think if he is out the door, and I think if he does end up getting moved, Anaheim probably looking around that first overall pick once again. So for this Pacific Division, I have 5 teams making the playoffs. I have the Edmonton Oilers finishing in first, Vegas finishing in second, the LA Kings finishing in third, Calgary finishing in the first wildcard spot, and the Seattle Kraken finishing in the second wildcard spot, with Vancouver, San Jose, and Anaheim missing the playoffs this year. Thank you very much for watching this video breaking down all 4 divisions in the NHL headed into the 2023-2024 season. This is definitely a really exciting season. I think there are many teams that may not make the playoffs this year that have solid rosters, so I'm curious to see how this ends up playing out. If you haven't had the chance to check out any of our other content, we'd really appreciate it if you can go back and do so. It would help us out if you can like, subscribe, and don't forget to ring that bell so you won't miss any future uploads.